Good evening, everyone, and welcome. It's wonderful to have you here on this beautiful spring night in the middle of January. The temperature actually reached 70 degrees today in Washington, and I looked back for 25 years, and the last time it was even close to this warm was in 1995. It was 63 degrees, so it's clear that Washington is heated up. I'm Margaret Lowe. I'm president of Atlantic Live, and welcome to this Atlantic Exchange. This has been an intense week in the world of politics. President Obama said farewell in Chicago. President-elect Donald Trump held his first post-election news conference, just as many of his Senate nominees were facing Senate confirmation. There's so much to consider in all that's unfolding here in this city and around the world, but tonight we're going to zoom in on where the battle with ISIL or ISIS or the Islamic State is headed. The world hasn't agreed on what to call this group, but the world certainly knows how lethal they are and how far their radical notions have traveled to San Bernardino, Nice, Berlin, Turkey, and beyond. In his farewell address this week, President Obama said, "ISIL will be destroyed," and he went on to say, "No one who threatens America will ever be safe." So we have the perfect people here tonight to reflect on that statement. Brett McGurk, the Obama administration's special envoy for Global Coalition to Counter ISIL, is here. And The Atlantic's Graeme Wood. Graeme is the author of the new book, The Way of the Strangers, Encounters with the Islamic State, and also the author of the 2015 Atlantic cover story, What ISIS Really Wants. We hope tonight's conversation provides plenty of fuel for Twitter. We are using the hashtag ATLX, and we'll also leave time for questions. So with that, it is my great pleasure to welcome Graeme Wood and Brett McGurk. They're here with my colleague, our editor-in-chief, Jeff Goldberg, who will lead the conversation. Jeff, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Margaret. Hello, everyone, and welcome. We are going to jump right into this. I just want to say thank you to Brett for showing up. Graeme has to show up because he works for me, but I wanted to thank you for taking time out of your busy fighting ISIS schedule to show up. As many of you know Brett already. He's made himself into one of the world's leading experts on this. The other one of the world's leading experts is Graeme. Margaret mentioned his astonishing work on this subject over the years. This is the new book. It's a wonderful book, and I encourage all of you to read it, and more importantly, to buy it. I would also note that Graeme's cover story, 2015, is, by all of the metrics we have, the most read article or post or any sort of feature in the history of The Atlantic, and The Atlantic is turning 160 years old this year, so you've beaten the Battle Hymn of the Republic, which we published first in 1862, which did not go viral, by the way, like yours did. But let me just start, if you don't mind, with Brett. President Obama has said says inside the White House, and has said this for a year or more, that what he hopes to have done by January 20th is to leave his successor a clean barn, a quote-unquote clean barn. To the best of my understanding, felt as if he was handed a somewhat messy barn, an economic, financial crisis, 150,000 troops in Iraq and Afghanistan, neither war at the moment was being won by a long shot, and he wanted to hand over a clean barn. So my question to you at this moment is, on the question of ISIS, is this administration handing over a clean barn to Donald Trump?
Let me first, thanks, Jeff. It's a real honor to be here, and thank you, Atlantic. It's a real honor to be here with Graeme, whose writings on this topic are insightful, and I've read them all, and I think some of the most important work being done on how these people actually think, which is what we have to understand to defeat them. To answer your question, this is the second transition I've gone through. So I was in I was a senior director on the NSC for President Bush when we did the transition to President Obama, and I stayed on with the Obama team. We worked very hard then at the direction of President Bush to make sure we were handing off a policy I was working on primarily on Iraq that was sustainable and that could be carried forward without a major crisis, and I think we actually succeeded in that pretty well. President Obama's kind of given us the same direction to make sure that we're doing everything we possibly can to support the transition. I think on this topic, I can say the transition has gone very well, very substantive meetings. I feel pretty good about it. We are now in a place in the campaign where what we are handing off, I think, gives the incoming administration a lot of opportunities to make some changes if they want, and every administration wants to make some changes, but also with some momentum against ISIS. I'll use ISIS because just common parlance. We analyze this threat, and it is an unprecedented threat, really, in three dimensions. I'll focus on the first, but the first is the core in Iraq and Syria, the physical caliphate. We believe strongly that to get at this movement, this narrative, you have to defeat the physical caliphate, and we're doing that. There's global networks, which we can talk about, and then there's about 7 or 8 affiliates around the world. But to defeat the physical caliphate, you have to get them out of their two major capitals, which are Mosul and Raqqa. And in Mosul, we now have an ongoing military campaign that has momentum. We hope to have the eastern side of the city pretty much done by the end of the month, early February. And then we will reset for the western side of the city. There are definitely things the Trump administration can do to maybe accelerate. In the Bush administration, remember, we had about 20 decisions that said, what are decisions we'd want to hand over? What are decisions we have to make now? Kind of run through a similar process here. In Raqqa, we are now in position, and Raqqa is very important because it is the administrative capital of ISIS, it is where their leaders are, and most importantly, it is where there's significant, what we call external plotting, external operations, their planning is taking place. It's where they sit and plan and plot external attacks. Not the inspired attack, you know, the guy with a truck, but the kind of Brussels, Paris. They aspire to do a 9/11 type spectacular attack. We're doing everything we can to make sure they can't do that. I don't think they will do that, but where they're trying to plan that is in Raqqa. Raqqa is very difficult because, unlike Iraq, we're not working with a government. We're not working with an army. We have to work with local actors and organize them into a military force, but we're now at a point in Raqqa where what we will transition over is a city that is more or less isolated and a force that is building momentum to actually seize Raqqa. I would say in the first half of this year, I think that's possible. So I feel pretty good about it. This is an extremely difficult endeavor. The Trump administration has made clear it is their number one priority to defeat ISIS. I completely agree with that. Secretary-designate Tillerson said yesterday, if everything's a priority, nothing's a priority. Our priority has to be to defeat ISIS. I think that is absolutely the right approach. And I think what we have in place now gives them some flexibility to make some changes, but also I think what we're handing off is a pretty sustainable policy.
There was a lot of hope earlier that by now you would have finished with Mosul. Why hasn't it gone as fast as a lot of people expected it would?
I never said that. I think we always knew this would take an extremely long time. Mosul is a huge city with about 1 million people. It's very dense. It is the national capital of ISIS. It is where Baghdadi declared his caliphate. They'll do everything they possibly can to hold on to it. Suicide bombers, all sorts of very multi-layered defenses. It is going to take a long time. So, but overall, the campaign plan is actually kind of where we thought it would be. We had to reset the force moved into Mosul and got faced some really fierce resistance. And we took about 3 weeks to reset some things, work with the Iraqis to launch a new push, which they launched on December 30th. And now they're actually clearing entire neighborhoods kind of each day. So it's moving. I think anyone who predicted this would be fast, I think, isn't paying attention to the nature of this enemy, which Graham knows as well as anyone. This is a fanatical, suicidal enemy. They are a strong military force. And when you're defending urban terrain, and you're using civilians as human shields, which they do, it's extremely difficult.
How many suicide attacks have you seen since the push began in the periphery of Mosul and exiting Mosul toward forces that are aligned with you?
We have now, and the suicide statistics are important because we still assess most of the suicide bombers, nearly all of them, are foreign fighters. And so to get at this enemy, you have to cut down the number of foreign fighters coming into this theater, Syria and Iraq, which we've done. It's gone from 100 a month or so. It's really down to like a handful now a month of these guys getting in. But they've been able to muster at times about 100 suicide bombers a month. We have seen this at every single phase of the campaign, battle after battle. In Syria, Kobani, Shadadi, a town called Al-Hal, Manbij in Iraq, Ramadi, Fallujah, Tikrit. They are able to come with an intense array of suicide bombers week after week sometimes. And Kobani went on for 6 months. I mean, thousands of these guys basically impaling themselves on the defenses of Kobani. And then they eventually reach a culmination point. And you don't know when that culmination point's going to come. It will come in Mosul. I mean, we're already seeing from 10 to 15, sometimes 20 suicide V-bids a week. Now it's, you know, it's just a handful.
I mean, can you figure out when they're going to run out of people who want to do that?
It's hard to figure. Every battle has had a culmination point, and we've been at this now for some time. So again, it will come in Mosul. It's just hard to say. Look, there's a chance it could pop real fast, and Mosul could fall tomorrow. There's also a chance that this could go on, I think, until June. I think we have to be prepared for both scenarios.
Graeme, before I ask you what you think the Obama administration has gotten right in this fight, tell me what you think they've gotten wrong, to the extent that you think that they've gotten something wrong. And you could reach back to the initial wave that led to the capture of Mosul, if you want.
It wasn't, I think, principally an error of the Obama administration that Mosul fell. My understanding is that the Obama administration was aware of the problems that were leading to this. They were aware that there was this movement that was aspiring to take the city of Mosul. And it was simply a lack of capability, actually, to put the necessary pressure to keep that from happening. That is, having left Iraq, the points of leverage didn't exist. So what I think the bigger problem that we saw in the aftermath of that was a kind of slow appreciation of the way that ISIL had become a global movement of inspiration. So this long period of immigration.
Cognitive failure, but sort of an understanding that the ideology was spreading everywhere?
Yeah, so it starts off as we have a very large city in Iraq that's about to fall, and this is an Iraqi problem. And then quickly it became something much bigger. When I talk to people about the ways that they saw ISIL's expansion, they thought of it in global terms, in cosmic terms, and they certainly didn't think of it as a local problem in Iraq. It wasn't a failure of governance by the Maliki government. It was a sign that something that would move the hearts of all true Muslims was underfoot. So I think if there had been perhaps an earlier realization of that type of inspiration, then maybe some of the movement of foreign fighters to Iraq would have been slowed a bit earlier.
So answer this question, and I'll let Brett follow on this. If he wins, and let's assume that Mosul and Raqqa fall to U.S.-allied forces or anti-ISIL forces, does that make the world a safer place, or could it make the world a more dangerous place? If you smash down on this anthill, does it just spread, or have you actually reversed their narrative in a way that's useful?
I think I'm all in favor of the smashing. Mosul is a great example of the way that the caliphate has positioned itself in the case of Mosul as a military fulfillment of scripture, in the case of Raqqa as a kind of utopian fulfillment of scripture. So in one case it is.
Explain that a little bit more.
Yeah. So in the case of Mosul, it is, this is how we fight. This is how we hearken to precedent in Islamic history. They were speaking of the Battle of the Trench as the template for the way that they would fight. So when we see in the Battle of the
Trench. 2 10 seconds on the Battle of the Trench.
And the Battle of the Trench involved the defense of the city of Medina when Muhammad's tribesmen from the city of Mecca came to fight against him. And it was the strategy for victory that Muhammad successfully pursued was to terraform the city of Medina so it couldn't be attacked by this coalition. So they said, the Iraqis, the Kurds, Americans, and beyond, this is the coalition that resembles the coalition of Meccans that came to fight against Muhammad, and we will draw out this battle by digging trenches, by digging tunnels in the case of Mosul, and we will outlast them. So that's the kind of scriptural historical template that they've used in the case of Mosul. In the case of Raqqa, it's still more of a place of this utopian dream. It's where you can live rather than die, and live in a fully Islamic way. So when Mosul is taken back, when Raqqa is taken back, these are two pillars of inspiration, I think, that will the dividends from having taken them back will be significant. I mean, if you can no longer claim to be successful along the model that you've claimed for yourself, militarily or as a civilization that wants to continue to survive, then you don't have much left as inspiration for the foreign fighters who previously you were having such success in drawing toward you.
But Brett, Al-Qaeda, for instance, has never held territory that many Muslims thought were very important, and yet they have a certain staying power. Do you think that if you defeat them, defeat ISIS territorially, you will have defeated the ideology? And I remember once having a conversation with General Mattis about this, in fact, that the way you defeat the enemy is to convince the enemy that he's lost. Do you think that you'll have convinced people who support ISIS around the world that the cause is no longer worth fighting for?
I mean, ISIS is a branch of Al-Qaeda, so you can go back to Zarqawi and read what Zarqawi said in 2004.
Well, it's a spinoff.
Yeah, so Syrian civil war, you basically have a split. I mean, the split was basically Baghdadi believing we have to declare a caliphate, and the Al-Qaeda guys still reporting to Zawahiri saying, no, we're not going to do that, put a target on our backs. That's the basic split. But by declaring a caliphate, and Graeme has documented this, this became a global phenomenon, one of the things that just launched the global phenomenon. And so to defeat the physical caliphate, you're not going to end ISIS as a threat, as a movement, but you take away its main reason for existence. Again, Graeme said something very important. I mean, most of their propaganda early on was not the beheading videos and that. It was these scenes of, I've described them before, as these sun-drenched scenes of children running around and bring your family and your friends to the homeland and constantly expanding. Their catchphrase was retain and expand the caliphate. And that was attracting people from all around the world. And so you have to defeat the physical caliphate to defeat ISIS. However, radical jihadism, Al-Qaeda, these movements that are going to be with us for some time will not be defeated by defeating the physical caliphate. But ISIS as a phenomenon, a necessary condition, not sufficient condition, you have to get them out of Raqqa and Mosul and defeat their physical, take away their physical space.
Okay, you have a situation, the president you work for right now, gotten in rhetorical trouble repeatedly for under-promising. You recall very, very early on, he talked about dismantling, but degrading first. The president-elect has made some pretty florid promises about the defeat of ISIS that will come about quickly once he's president. Is it plausible for the president-elect to have made these promises? Do you think that we will experience ISIS attacks either against American targets here or overseas, if Mosul and Raqqa are taken? And then the important question for you is what do you think the Trump administration response will be, and what would you recommend it be?
I mean, I can't speak for the Trump administration. I can just say I think the policy of, at risk of repeating myself, defeating a physical caliphate, killing Baghdadi, which will happen, really starts to unravel what ISIS is as a movement. You're a long way to defeating them. I think that has to be a fundamental priority. I understand it is a priority of the Trump administration. It's something I completely agree with. In terms of attacks, there's two types of attacks. There's the directed attack. Again, the Paris, the Brussels, the very sophisticated attacks, with guys actually coming out of Syria to conduct attacks that are planned, and these inspired attacks.
And we've never had the first category here.
We've not had a directed attack here. Look, it's extremely difficult to stop an individual like Orlando Martin in Orlando that at the last moment declares himself allegiance to Baghdadi. But if you look at his history, he's had all sorts of personal problems, and he's declared fidelity to Hezbollah. I mean, he's just, that's very different than an attack coming and planned from Raqqa. Those things are very difficult to stop. Those are law enforcement problems. We're doing a lot in the country to get a handle on that. But I think we do have to distinguish between the two. I also think it's just a reality that we will have crimes by people then saying, I'm an ISIS person. And I don't think we should give them all credit that they are ISIS. A lot of them are just, crazy people.
What would constitute a counterproductive response to an ISIS-inspired attack in the United States?
We have fought the war in Iraq and Syria. We're kind of pioneering how we do this. It's limited U.S. military force. We are not putting Americans deep into the streets of Mosul, although they are in harm's way. They are accompanying Iraqi forces, but they are not doing the fighting. Iraqi forces, I see the former ambassador from Iraq to the United States, Luqman Faili, here. Iraqi forces are fighting, taking casualties. Similar in Syria, working with locals, fighting, taking a lot of casualties to retake this territory. I still think it would be a mistake to put U.S. combat forces on the ground to root out this threat. One thing we have done over the last 2 years, and I think one reason the language was measured 2 years ago, was the situation we faced was a totally collapsed Iraqi military structure, a brand new fledgling government, nothing in Syria that we could work with, and it was hard to see how we were going to do this. We put a plan together, and I think we actually followed that plan. But I think local forces taking back territory is critical. Of the territory we've retaken from ISIS to date, and it's about 60% in Iraq, it's now up to almost 30% in Syria, and most significantly, most of the populated areas, ISIS has not retaken any of that land. And that is because before we do an operation, we do extensive planning with the forces that are going to move in, how we're going to do it, what comes afterwards in terms of stabilization, humanitarian support. So this is not, when we were in Iraq, we would do clear, hold, and then AQI at the time would come back. Until we did the surge, we changed our tactics. Working through locals, enabling locals is the right strategy. I think putting U.S. combat forces on the ground to take on this enemy would not be a constructive approach.
Graeme, domestically, what would constitute in your mind a mistake? Let's assume, God forbid, Orlando, San Bernardino-style attack. The president-elect has promised much more drama than President Obama promised or enacted in his term, not only in rhetoric, but in his promised action. What would constitute a proper response? What would constitute a counterproductive response?
I think that the very fact of what Brett just said about the difficulty of disrupting this type of attack, if we allow ourselves to say that anyone who pledges himself to ISIS before committing this attack is an ISIS attacker, and then we treat this as a full-fledged ISIS attack, a directed attack, then we are doing roughly what ISIS is hoping. That they are hoping that every little attack is one that will be treated as a grave national emergency and a case of ISIS adopting successfully a kind of old school Al-Qaeda model and having a spectacular attack. So the way that we could counterproductively approach that, I think, certainty that will eventually happen, is to grant them that favor, to overreact rhetorically would be enough. They've realized, and this is their great innovation in the domestic terror sphere, that they get as much bang for their buck in having a individual person stab a few people at a mall as you can get from a much higher body count and a much more difficult to more planned out attack. So I think what we would hope to have as a response would be one that treats it with the gravity that it actually represents, which is a tragedy, but a small number of people dead and not evidence that the enemy is one that is actually plotting 9/11 style attacks successfully, just because we see an individual with perhaps mental problems, acting vocally on his behalf.
Graeme, I want to come in a second to some of your work on your writing about the radicalization of Americans, but I want to come back to you just one more minute on this question. Are you worried that a reaction of the Trump administration to a ISIS-inspired attack would be to declare the imposition or the adoption of a Muslim registry, for instance, or to radically limit travel from Muslim-majority countries. Are these things that keep you up at night?
I can just speak from my experience over the last month. I've been very encouraged all of my interactions with the incoming Trump team. So,
no one has suggested these kind of things?
No, I have not heard that. And we've had very good substantive exchanges about different options and how to go about this. So I've actually been quite encouraged by the transition and how it's going.
Graeme, talk for a minute, if you will. Maybe you could tell the story that you told in this month's Atlantic about the Texan you discovered who has become something of a senior ISIS operative. Tell that story very quickly, if you can, and tell us what it means in terms of ISIS ideology's ability to move people who otherwise you wouldn't think would be moved in the direction of ISIS. What does it mean for U.S. national security?
Yeah, it might help to give a bit of the backstory of how I even found this guy. When I spoke to one of ISIS's main recruiters in Australia, he just offhandedly mentioned the Arabic nickname for an individual who he regarded as his teacher. And I assumed when he first said it that this was a person he knew well, someone at whose feet he had learned, and he refused to say more. So I thought I had reached an impasse, but I started looking more, and I started to find an online community that this person had been part of, that he had been really a kind of leader within, English-speaking leader. Long story short, eventually I found that he was an American. His name is John Georgelis. He's about 33 years old, and as of last month, happy birthday, John. And he had a kind of online virtual following that was made real, and this was a great example of why the physical reality of the caliphate mattered so much. It was an ideological commitment that he had to go to a caliphate once it existed, but it was also a kind of online fantasy life that he had. It was intellectualized. He had taught himself Arabic to a very impressive degree. And when the Syrian Civil War broke out...
His ethnic background is?
He is a white American. He's a kind of classic American suburban kid who spends too much time at his computer, a kind of pudgy, neck-bearded basement troll who really enjoys his computer and whose hobby eventually turned toward radical Islam and jihad. But he, like a lot of people who enjoy their computers a little bit too much, he had this kind of community that he was part of online. And eventually he found that if he went to Syria, he could get the band together for the first time in reality. It was all of his followers showing up and treating him like a real life leader. So that's what he is. He eventually made it to Raqqa. We know that he's there. We know that he's one of the chief propagandists for the Islamic State. He's written a large part of this glossy magazine some of you might subscribe to called Dabiq, and he's still out there. But he's one of these people who if you look at his story, you could see any number of ways in which he could have been diverted to something else. But once the caliphate existed, he felt like he had no choice. He told his followers, I got to go there, and so do you. And in the absence of that, I think he might still be the lord of his own Facebook group. Instead, he's running a propaganda.
You don't think he, if he had stayed in America, you don't think he would have committed an act of self-radicalized terrorism?
He was definitely radicalized in America before the existence of ISIS. But what was that radicalism doing? He was a big pot smoker. He was a computer tech guy who did commit a felony in the form of accessing the password of APAC at his job at Rackspace, a data center. So it was small beer stuff. And I think it might have stayed that way if he didn't feel, first of all, an ideological commitment to sign up for any caliphate that arose, and then the ability, once one actually showed up, to go there and you know, find the glory that he never got in his life in Dallas, Texas.
Just one more turn on that, because it's so, well, I believe it's very, very unusual. What was the triggering event in his life that sent him down this path, do you think?
Well, he converted to Islam soon after 9/11. I think that...
You know why?
We don't really know why. We know that it was fairly sudden, that he had a very very Christian upbringing, and he didn't really please his dad. So I think there was an element of rebellion, of kind of Oedipal rebellion, that took a very, very unfortunate turn. And that
Oedipal rebellion, and then there's Oedipal rebellion.
Yeah, this is Oedipal rebellion.
Yeah.
So
he
that was in, as I say, 2001. So yeah. It took a few years from there before he just started traveling the world, started learning about different forms of Islam. Unfortunately, learning about the forms of Islam that one would least like him to learn about, and finding intellectual bedfellows in London. And eventually in Syria. So he at no point can you say that this is the moment when it happened. But there is a moment when you could see that the commitment that he had claimed before, the commitment to eventually finding an imam who he would be behind,
right.
When that was the requirement was also felt that he actually go to Syria and commit to that.
Brett, three related questions. The first is, how many Americans do you believe have gone to join ISIS in its territorial space? The second is, do you worry in the way that European governments worry that one of these types will work his way back to United States soil? And the third question is the obvious one, do you know about this guy, and is he on your radar, and what does that mean?
I hope he has some life insurance, because if he stays in Syria, he's purported in his very good article to trying to take the place of Mohammed Adnani, who was really the kind of operational mastermind of ISIS, who we killed in a targeted strike a few months ago. He's not a replacement for Adnani, but he might aspire to that. I would just say there, we are really inside the network now, taking down the leaders, and I've been to Syria a few times. Our guys who are working this are doing just an incredible job. They did a very risky raid just the other day that was very successful. So that is like ongoing. It's something I think it's important for Americans to know that. We have our best guys and women in harm's way doing incredible work to defeat this enemy every single day, very quietly. We track Americans that go to Syria. Total number of Americans that travel to Syria for all sorts of reasons is about 260.
Per year?
Well, no, total.
Totally.
And we think to join various fighting groups inside Syria. The statistic the FBI used about 10 a month were going about a year ago. Now it's like one or none a month. So we've really cut down. It's very hard to get into Syria now. In fact, in their own propaganda, ISIS says, you know, don't come to Syria, go to Libya. And now they really have nowhere to go in Libya. But we track extremely closely Americans who have tried to go to Syria, Americans who are still in Syria, who they are, and if they come out and travel around, we will know. This is something the FBI and our law enforcement community is all over. It is a concern, but it is part of all of our focus areas. Western passport holders, particularly Americans who may have traveled to Syria, is a prime focus. If they try to come back, we'll know it.
Talk about this one young man.
So he was not on my, at least not on my radar screen until I read the article. But I can't say he was not on the radar screen of others who really focus on the individuals who are trying to track down. But it's a very interesting story about the radicalization process, about the nature of why the notion of a caliphate is so important. I travel all around the world as part of my position. Last year, I was overseas my staff counted about 212 days in the last year overseas in capitals and all over the place. And we always ask, you know, especially the law enforcement community, others in these capitals, what is it about ISIS that has attracted your young people to travel to Syria? The highest number of foreign fighters have come from Tunisia, which is seen as a jewel of the Arab Spring. But you know, why are so many young people going from Tunisia? And the common denominator answer we get all the time is this notion of this caliphate, this historic movement that people need to be a part of. We see that all the time. And some Americans have been caught up in this.
I think in Georgeless's case, John Georgeless, you see...
What is he known as now, by the way? Tell people what he's known
he's
as.
He's now known as Yahya Abu Hassan. And he's gone by many different nicknames over the years, but that seems to be the one that's kind of stuck. When we look at the reasons that he went over there and what he's done since going over there, we start to see that the whole diversity of motivations that people have, too. So when he first went there, it was that getting the band together kind of mentality. And then he went to fight. He, despite having a very kind of bookish mentality, he really styles himself a scholar. He made sure that he went to the front lines, and he wrote back to his Muslim and non-Muslim friends about the glory that he felt as his spine was nearly severed in a mortar blast. So he did that. But then we also know that he saw himself as a scholar, someone who was producing ideological material and convincing other people about what they need to believe as Muslims. And then there's this other element of his writing back home, again, to family, to friends, includes a sense of family life. So he's in Raqqa, he has a family there, he has kids who have been born in Syria, he sees this as a civilization that he has joined. So fighting, scholarship, civilization, all of these things seem to have been things that have pushed him over there, and we should be thinking about all of these things as the idealizations of life under the caliphate that are pushing a lot of people.
Brett, two questions about your coalition. Or the first is the obvious, the most important one. Do you consider Russia an ally in the fight against ISIS?
No, I definitely would not go that far.
Say that into the microphone.
Yeah, no, I would not. I would not go that far. What do you consider that? Well, let me say, if you look at the situation in Syria, and you just look at the situation we have, the debates about how we got here, we have a caliphate, ISIS caliphate. We have an al-Qaeda safe haven in the northwest in Idlib province, which is, they used to call themselves a Nusra Front. That's core al-Qaeda, reports to Zawahiri. One of the largest al-Qaeda safe havens since 9/11. We have an ongoing civil war, and Russia is a power in that country. And so while our expectations have to be modest, we have to be realistic. Looking for areas where we can cooperate with the Russians on Syria is something that makes sense. That's something that we have tried in various ways. There is no way that you either are going to go through Russia to settle down Syria, which means a conflict, or you're going to find some way to work with them on Syria. So I do think it makes sense to try to find areas of mutual interest and overlap, because the situation in Syria is so complex. Our tools, frankly, are limited, and it is an extremely serious situation. I think our interests in Syria are defeating ISIS, defeating that al-Qaeda safe haven, and settling down the civil war. So there are various ways to do that, and invariably, Russia will be at the table, and we have to be at the table. So an ally of fighting ISIS, certainly not, but in terms of...
Have they done anything to help you?
Well, I will say, you know, we negotiated with the Russians, and I was a part of these negotiations early on, a cessation of hostilities that we put in place in March. Everyone was skeptical, and then it actually worked in the first month. I mean, violence in Syria went way down. And if you look at the Russian airstrikes in that first month to 6 weeks, it actually shifted about 80% against ISIS. And the Syrian army shifted their focus to Palmyra. And the Russians were telling us at the time they didn't want to go from Palmyra to Deir ez-Zor, which is way east, which is where the Syrian army is surrounded by ISIS. Very serious situation. And then for various reasons, spoilers all across the whole thing just kind of unraveled, and the fighting then flared up again in Aleppo. So I wouldn't say they've done nothing against ISIS. Palmyra is one example. But then when you start to focus on the propping up Assad civil war side, lo and behold, ISIS retakes Palmyra. In our coalition campaign against ISIS, as I said, everything we've taken from them, they haven't taken back. That's important. So were Russia to say, hey, we're really going to focus on ISIS and defeating the caliphate and actually working on the core al-Qaeda problem, there might be some areas of convergence there. But you know, we're not there yet.
It's not possible to imagine right now, but if the Assad regime were to fall, do you think ISIS would be the replacement, or ISIS-style organizations would be the replacement?
Again, I personally think, having lived through the Iraq experience, if the Assad regime were to fall, I think you would have just total chaos in which extremists would fill the void. And again, the discussions with the Russians, just to give an anecdote of how they go, we have had a theory of the case that you can remove Assad and his lieutenants, put in a new government, settle down the civil war, re-engage in Syria, rebuild Syria. The Russians, and some of it might be disingenuous, but this is what they believe, and I tell them blue in the face, have been in negotiations with them. They describe this as like an upside-down pyramid. If you remove Assad and his key people, the whole institutional structure collapses. And so that is one reason why there might be some opportunities as the regime actually shores up its areas, because then that argument is not quite as persuasive to see some political outcomes. But this is a critical question. I mean, you have to answer the question of what comes after before you say that government has to go. Especially what we've seen in terms of how fast extremist groups fill these vacuums.
Are you suggesting, just to be clear, that on occasion Russian officials have been disingenuous with U.S. officials in their negotiations?
Negotiations with them, you have to be incredibly skeptical.
Graeme, you want to add something?
Yeah, when I think about Russia, and I'm thinking about the afterlife of the caliphate, if we assume that in 6 months or so it's possible that Raqqa will fall, it's possible that Mosul will have fallen, then we have to remember that the number of Russian citizens and people from the Russian sphere of influence who have gone to fight on ISIS's side is probably in the order of 5,000.
I mean, Uzbek,
these are Dagestanis. Chechens, but they would include some Tajiks who have gone usually through Moscow and been radicalized.
Putin
there.
Has a legitimate fear.
There, 5,000 Russians compared to 250, many of whom are dead, of Americans who have gone over there. This is a serious problem. I mean, there is land contiguity that would allow a return. And when ISIS loses this territory, they have plans locally of a kind of return to the desert that they might have, but they also have plans in their periphery, which includes havoc that they can wreak in the home countries of the foreign fighters and territory that they can take back. So I think this is perhaps a point of common interest here.
I want to loop back to that, but I wanted to just ask Brett this, because you talked about you've made the assertion that the FBI has the situation as concerns 260 or so Americans under control. You are spending a lot of time with European allies. There's a widespread feeling that that situation is not nearly as under control as the situation here might be. Why does it seem, at least from something of a distance, that the European security agencies are really half a step to a full step behind on this? And how and what would happen when you what will happen when you smash down thoroughly on Raqqa and Mosul? How many people with European passports do you think will be able to get back to Europe?
Let me follow up briefly on something Graeme said. It's important about how the Russians see this. Metrojet was a Russian airliner that took off from the Sinai, was brought down by a soda can that, won't say definitively, but more likely than not, was an ISIS attack. They took credit for it. And if that was a U.S. airliner, think of how that would have affected us. So it is a significant threat to Russia, and the extent to which they can direct the Assad regime against that threat is something that I think we have to demand of them as a core element in any negotiation. Your European partners, since I've been doing this for some time, you know, we had a wake-up call, obviously, on 9/11. We have totally reformed how we share information from federal, state, to local authorities. We saw that under the UN General Assembly week when you had a couple bombings in New York and how that guy was captured, within a day or so based upon close cooperation from Washington with local authorities, state authorities, and authorities in New York. Really extraordinary work by our law enforcement professionals. European systems, and I'm not a law enforcement expert, but I'm over there all the time, and what we're encouraging them to do is, you know, more information sharing, breaking down silos, all the things that we have done. And we have seen a marked improvement since the Brussels attacks, the Paris attacks, particularly the French, working extremely closely with the French, have broken up plots, working with the French. The French are also doing an awful lot in the Sahel against some ISIS remnants down there. And also working with Belgium and others. So we have seen an improvement, but our mantra to our partners in the coalition, and we have a coalition because we need a global network to defeat what is a global network, is I call it radical information sharing. It's a different way of thinking about this problem. You have to break down silos and share information to the lowest level. It's the only way to do it. Just one quick example. Interpol is a member of our coalition. The gold standard is that we have so much information now on ISIS, on the foreign fighters, on who they are and where they come from, on their connections and their networks. We have a database. And we want to be able to share that database. And the gold standard is that if you're an Interpol country, you can actually have a database, so your local cop has the same handheld as a border official, and that you're able to check in a routine traffic stop, you know, does this person have a connection to Syria or something else? You can do that within authorities that exist, and that's what we're trying to encourage. It is information sharing, information sharing, information sharing. And it's getting better in Europe, but you know, clearly they have a ways to go. But we can help, because we went through the same thing over 10 years ago.
We're going to go to questions in a minute, but I just want to come to Graeme with one other question. You've studied these patterns for years. Let's assume, it's a big assumption, that ISIS is defeated in its territorial manifestation. What comes next? Now, ISIS is Al-Qaeda 2.0. What is ISIS 2.0? Will this ideology, which is rooted, as you have argued persuasively, in actual Muslim theology, one particular strain of Muslim theology, will this die out, or are we going to see some wholly new thing that's possibly going to be even more frightening than ISIS?
Yeah, I've had ISIS ideologues tell me, you can't stop us. Why can't you stop us? Because we have a caliphate. And what constitutes a caliphate? Well, even if you just have one city street, one block in a village in southern Philippines that has a single imam, and that
or a slum in Belgium.
It would have to be a place where you can openly implement Islamic law along the lines that they believe is correct. As long as you have that, the caliphate survives. I find that I could live with the idea of maybe one city street in a village in the southern Philippines belonging to ISIS.
I don't think McGurk can, but
the idea though that this would be would continue to be the same kind of beacon that having a fairly large territory in Syria and Iraq is, that doesn't hold water. So what I think we'll find is that there are some people who never give up on this idea and who think that there is still enough to fight for when there is any territory at all. But I think for a lot of others, we'll find that they decide to go back to the drawing board. So they've watched an attempt to establish a caliphate. They watched a lot of big promises being made by ISIS and failing to be fulfilled. And they'll look for a different way to channel their energies.
Who's right? Barack Obama, who says that this is a manageable problem, or Donald Trump, who says this is a defeatable problem?
Well, I think it is a defeatable.
I'm drawing a crude representation of their views, but not inaccurate.
So my view is that it is defeatable in its current manifestation, but there are longer trends that we're looking at: trends in history, trends in social trends, religious trends, trends in interpretation that ISIS represents. The idea that the forms of authority that existed before—religious authority, political authority. That these are not working, and something else must be tried, that will continue. Now, whether the things that are tried will take this especially brutal, intolerant form, I doubt it will be. It will look quite like ISIS. But this is a much broader generational thing that ISIS is one manifestation of.
I'm going to go to questions. I'll come over here and then over here. We're down here in the front, in second row, if you don't mind. Right there.
Lukman Faili, previous Iraqi ambassador. Brett, thank you very much for all the hard work, and I hope the next administration keep you in the various hard work you've been doing, and if not, just keep the experience you have done. The question I have is, with the sense of urgency I see in the Trump administration in relation to the fight, is it the focus would be against the theme of the brand of ISIS or the theme of jihadist Salafism? Does the war finish with ISIS going away, or is it a long-term project?
You want to try that one?
I mean, I can tell you how you have to defeat ISIS for all the reasons we've said, but you also have to continue to fight the phenomenon of Al-Qaeda and jihadism. So, you know, this is something that is going to go on for some time. There are different dimensions to the fight, but it's not just ISIS.
Some of the distinctions that you made, I think, are very important. And when I hear the Trump administration, its officials saying that radical Islam is our target, then I hope to hear them making exactly those kinds of distinctions and making and deciding its priorities accordingly. That, I think, is step one, distinguishing between ISIS, other types of jihadi Salafism, other types of Islamism, and deciding which ones are actually threats, which ones can be lived with, and what we need to focus on. I certainly think that in the short term, enormous emphasis should be placed on ISIL in particular.
There was a question down here, yeah, over here, and then I'll come to the back.
Thank you. Joseph Bahut from Carnegie. Two questions, one for Mr. McGurk. You mentioned Russia. In fact, I had also a question about Iran in the struggle against ISIS, especially in Iraq, with the role of the Hashd al-Shaabi and others. I mean, besides the fact that it's choosing between, let's say, evils, quote unquote, but it's also the unintended effect of fueling, let's say, sectarianization in Iraq and also in Syria. The question for you, if I remember well your famous article in The Atlantic with, I think, Bernard Haykal at that time, or Bernard was in the picture, you said, and it was very courageous at that time, that although we decently want to consider that ISIS has nothing to do with Islam, in fact, it has a lot to do with some reading of Islam, if I understood you well. This is a very thin line and a very dangerous line politically. If the next administration is to read your article, don't you see a risk that it will confirm its own narrative in a kind of anti-Islamic, overall rhetoric?
If they read the article in the way that they wish, then they will find what they wish. If they actually read what the article says, I think they'll find exactly the kinds of
distinctions. You're describing your article the way people describe scripture, by the way.
Yes, exactly. There is some irony in that my article has infinite
very
interpretive
right.
breadth. But yes, my article attempted to describe what the distinctions are between different types of Islamist interpretation. One of them is ISIS. Other ones that are also literalist, that are also very conservative, were also described that are anti-ISIS. I suppose it's possible to read only the first 1,500 words and come up with an extremely destructive civilizational war out of it. But the following 8,500 words would, I hope, keep that from happening.
I would just real quick on your very important question. The sectarian narratives do not help. We do everything we possibly can to tamp it down. Iraq is very important because after Mosul, when Baghdad was teetering, you know, Grand Ayatollah Sistani issued this fatwa of which tens of thousands of Iraqis have joined up to fight. Most of those are patriotic nationalist Iraqis under the Sistani fatwa. We actually have about 30,000 Sunnis now operating under the umbrella of these popular mobilization forces, helping to hold the Sunni areas. It's been actually very successful. There are elements, though, underneath that umbrella that answer to the Iranians, and that is a very significant problem. It's a very significant issue that the Iraqi government has to confront, and this will be something that has to be confronted as ISIS is defeated. I know the Iraqi government is working at that to make sure all armed groups are brought under the control of the state. And I think ultimately Iranian influence in Iraq is self-limiting. I mean, there is an Iraqi nationalist impulse that is very strong, and the differences between Najaf and Qom are also very important. We don't have to get into all that. But this will be a very important trend line to watch, particularly as we get ISIS out of these populated areas.
There's a question back here.
Good evening, Paul Hughes from the U.S. Institute of Peace, and it's good to see you all again. The question that I have is long-term. We've talked tactical issues so far. You know, I want to get into the strategic realm. 15 to 20 years from now, we're going to see that this war has ended. And wars have political outcomes. It's just the nature of the beast. Do you believe that Syria really has a chance of remaining a sovereign state as we now know it, or are we going to see the international boundaries of a region that has many nations without states and states without nations change, and what's the impact for us?
And do it in tweet length, if you could do the answer.
I would just, the trend line is decentralization. So the fall of the post-Ottoman order, decentralization. In Iraq, I think it is a unified federal state that's embedded within their constitution, more local autonomy. That's something that's actually the policy of the Iraqi government we very much support. In Syria, I think something, decentralization is just realistic, similar to Libya. So that's kind of the trend line, more local autonomy, more decentralization. The days of kind of centrally driven states in these areas, I think, is something that is rapidly changing. So I think in terms of thinking ahead of how we prioritize protecting our interests, it's working with that decentralized structure, finding out who the local actors are, and making sure that threats cannot arise that threaten us.
Brett, I have to ask as a follow-up to that before I go to Graeme. Go into the time machine, go back to 2011, 2012. If you could do it over again, or if we could have done it over again, would you have... Was it a mistake not to support the moderate opposition? Remember the famous line, dentists and carpenters and farmers, from the president. Was there ever a chance that this could be nipped, this could have been nipped in the bud? Or was this heading where it was heading no matter what?
It's hard for me to answer. I think when you set the objective that Assad must go, you've set an objective of regime change, and I think the thinking in 2011...
Is that the consequential red line, then?
That's a very consequential policy choice. I think the thinking at the time, I was actually in Iraq at the time, was wake of the Arab Spring, which is very different than how we see things now. I'm not a believer that you can create an army out of nothing, and then I think some assumptions were fundamentally flawed back then. But the important thing about Syria is that we are where we are now, and what do you do going forward now? And you kind of can look at it zonally. There's, again, northwest Idlib, there's an al-Qaeda safe haven there. That's a real problem. There's where the Turks are, Euphrates Shield zone, Turkish influence, and they have their interests there. There's north of the Euphrates, there's a zone where Raqqa is. We're working with forces to make sure we defeat ISIS there. There's the core of the regime, which is where about 63% of the population still lives. And then we have to very focus on our allies, particularly Jordan, to make sure that they have a buffer on their southern border. So that's kind of how things are developing. So I think most important is here to think about where it is now and what you do going forward.
Yeah, I also agree that 10 to 15 years, I would be surprised if there's anything in Syria other than an extremely decentralized state. And if there was a centrally controlled, unified state, I would shudder to think what had happened that had allowed that to occur in the next 10 years. It probably would not have been a pretty process.
Charlie Stevenson, I teach at SAIS. Talk about the Kurds and the Turks. Can they be part of the solution, or are they just going to be part of the problem?
I've made about 20 trips to Turkey in the last 2.5 years. I've also spent time in Syria with balancing all of this, extremely difficult. One thing, again, as I said, building these tactical alliances on the ground, trying to focus everyone against a common threat of ISIS is extremely hard. And we're working this very carefully right now. There's obviously extraordinary tension, and it's something that we have to be very mindful of. We have to take into account, first and foremost, Turkey's very realistic national security concerns. It's a NATO ally. That's first and foremost on our minds. And we also have to have a viable plan for getting ISIS out of Raqqa, because we cannot leave them in Raqqa given the threats that we see emerging to us. So this is the balance. It's something we work on every single day. It is extraordinarily complex. And you know, we'll continue to try to walk that line.
Time for one more. Is there anybody?
Thank you. My name is Mutlu. I'm a Kurdish and Syrian affairs analyst. Brett, you mentioned about the centralization. What about the model the Kurds and their allies put on the ground? What do you think? And the second thing, you talked about Russia. What about the close relationship between Turkey and Russia? How is it affecting the fight against ISIS? Finally, you mentioned about Al-Qaeda enclave in Idlib. The Afrin Kurds are under ongoing attack of this Al-Qaeda. Why not more actively supporting your partners, that you and other officials repeatedly say that they are the most affected partner? Why not supporting them until Afrin?
It's a lot of questions. I will just say there's a lot of issues for Syrians to work out. And we want to help to be facilitators, but you know, we're not going to have directive answers. And so we will help support a Syrian-led political process to work a lot of these issues out. But I think the model of decentralization is something that I think is obviously realistic for the reasons we already said.
There's one final question I want to ask both of you. And I don't think it's a question that Brett gets every day. It's a little too ethereal for your work. But the question is, and Graeme and I have talked about this. You know, there's two ways of looking at this. There's the Huntington frame that this is we're in a clash of civilizations. There's another way of looking at it, that this is a clash within a civilization. My question to Brett and then to Graeme is, why is this happening in Muslim civilization? You've spent a lot of time traveling the Muslim world. What is underlying all of this? Can you you're coming to a marker in your career on this. I was wondering if you could reflect on that for a moment, and then maybe Graeme could comment on it to close this out.
You do have in the Arab world a youthful population with the highest unemployment rate in the world. And so you find, that's why even in countries where things seem to be moving the right way, like Tunisia, you find the highest number. That's one question I actually ask when I travel around the region to Saudi Arabia, other places. Like, I know the sectarian tensions, the problems with Iran, all of these grievances, but why is it in Tunisia, where you don't have those tensions, more people than any other country have traveled to Syria to join ISIS? And you need to create opportunities for young people, or they are susceptible to this ideology. You think about it. You're 16 or 17, and you were being promised be part of a historic movement, get a gun, get a house, you'll have friends, you get a girl. I mean, that's what they're pitching. The gore and everything is what we focus on in terms of propaganda, but it is just, it's an appeal to young people to have a life of meaning. And that's really what it is. And then the leadership is an indoctrinated ideology that we have to count on our Muslim partners, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, UAE, to help us combat. And I am confident that they are doing that. I mean, ISIS is a threat to Saudi Arabia. There's just a takedown of a couple guys the other day. And I spent a lot of time in Riyadh with the Saudis. This is something that is a fundamental threat to some of our closest allies and partners. But it is, you know, opportunity for young people is...
But if joblessness were a cause of terrorism, then Haiti would be a world center of terrorism. What is it about this part of the world? What is it about the ideology?
Well, I mean, Graeme has covered this. I mean, I agree with the core of the thesis. I mean, there is, if you are a Salafist or indoctrinated into a certain form of Islam, you might be about an 8 on a scale, and what ISIS does is pushes you to an 11. So basically, you're not a threat to society, but you have a certain set of beliefs. ISIS causes you to actually act on them and kill anyone that disagrees. So that is a very serious issue which our Muslim partners in our coalition have to help us combat. And they're doing so, but there's a long way to go.
Graeme, you want to wrap that up?
Yeah, I tend to see this in terms of longer trends, in terms of certain shocks that have overcome the Islamic world within the last 100 years or so. And these include the rise of literacy. The number of times I have finished a conversation with someone who was on the side of ISIS, and they've said to me as a kind of parting gift, if you want to know more, consult Sheikh Google, consult Sheikh YouTube, just punch into your search bar the questions of what a caliphate is and how ISIS fulfills it. This is a kind of democratization of interpretation of religious belief that was made possible by the fact that there are many more people who can read, many more people who feel like they can take into their own hands their religious interpretation, and they don't need to instead defer to the scholarly apparatus and institutions that in the past might have kept these particularly violent interpretations in check. So we have that, while many other different types of authority in the Islamic world are undermined, that there is no longer a sense that one can trust institutions of government any more than one can trust the imams that one is being asked to pray behind. All of these things come together, technology, and ISIS fills the gap. They're the ones who say, the forms of government didn't work, try us. The forms of religious interpretation didn't work, try us, try yourself. Just look at these scriptures and you will find a way to come to the same conclusions we have. None of these things would even have been possible in a period when there was, just by the certain facts of the amount of education people had and the accessibility of texts 100 years ago. Now they're there and no one has any idea how to keep a lid on the worst tendencies of the kind of homegrown interpreters who come to the ISIS conclusion.
Thank you very much, the two of you. This was a great conversation. Thank you very much to everyone for coming to this Atlantic Exchange. Appreciate it very much.